Good evening. I'd like to call the meeting to order. At this time, we'd like to ask Councilman Boudreaux to lead us in prayer and Councilman Castillo to lead us in the pledge.
Heavenly and most merciful Father, we ask that you be with us at this time of meeting. As we go through this agenda, we ask that you guide our thoughts, our words, and our actions. We ask special blessings and protection on all the employees of Lafayette Consolidated Government and all the citizens of the city and parish of Lafayette. We ask that you continue to heal our country, our state, and our city. These things we ask in your darling son, Jesus' name. Amen.
To the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, good evening. Thank you, Councilman Boudreaux, for the prayer. Thank you, Councilman Castillo, for leading us in the pledge. And thank you, citizens and communities, for watching on AOC, and thank you for being here this evening. Hope you all had a great Mardi Gras season and everyone was safe and caught a lot of beads and ate a lot of king cake. So we welcome you to the City Parish Council meeting. We, as your representatives in Lafayette Consolidated Government, welcome your involvement, encourage your participation. This meeting is a public hearing. If you wish to address the council on any item on this agenda, please fill out the request form in the foyer on the computer that is provided. The electronic request to address the council form must be filled out and submitted prior to the call of the agenda item, or you will not be given an opportunity to speak. If assistance is needed with submitting the request, staff is available to help. In the event a speaker has completed their comments prior to the expiration of their allotted 5 minutes, any remaining time shall be forfeited. If you have materials you wish to submit to the council, please give those to Council Clerk Ms. Veronica Williams, who is seated to my left. In effort to allow everyone opportunity to be heard, the 5 minute rule will be in effect. Speakers shall refrain from debating, personal attacks, and from making confrontational or derogatory comments. I'm requesting that the row in the first row in the front to my left be used for media only. And lastly, food and drinks are not allowed in the auditorium. And please, all phones, electronic devices shall be silenced from this point forward. I'm also requesting that anyone who approaches the council, please state your name and title for the official record. Meeting procedures are by resolution and not by Robert's Rules of Order. Documents including agenda, ordinances, resolutions, and minutes related to this meeting this evening is posted online at lafayettela.gov. Or you may refer to the web address on the top of the agenda item. The council encourages your involvement and participation by volunteering for boards and commissions. If you are interested in finding out which board suits your interests, please call 291-8800 or pick up a pamphlet at the door. Moving right along to chair announcements. Councilmember Liz Hebert is unable to attend tonight's meeting due to previous scheduled work event. Also, council item number 7, final adoption of resolution number 008-2018 relative to regional stormwater projects. The authors have requested an amendment to delete the word 3 from the title and a whereas clause and to add additional potential projects. Item 13, final adoption of resolution ordinance 014-2018 related to utilities, revenue bonds. The mayor, president, and legal have requested an amendment to make changes to the bond council and underwriting language. Item 18, final adoption of ordinance 017-2018 relative to the 2932 Ambassador Caffrey Parkway extension. Development and planning has requested a deferral into March the 6th meeting in order to allow time for the assessor to complete its certification. I would also at this time like to wish Mr. Bruce Comp, District 6 Councilman, a happy birthday, which he will celebrate on February 24th. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you, sir.
You're
too old.
Too old? Came in your bike tonight?
No.
Okay, just making sure. We got Uber now, Lafayette. You know that, right? Okay. Also, would like to announce that Councilman Bellard from District 5 will be arriving shortly. He got caught in traffic. And I will go ahead and also announce that I will take a chairman's privilege and will move item 21 out of its order when we get to final. That's for the police, the fire chief. He has a meeting tonight with the rating people who are coming in to rate our fire protection for the parish and the city. So he has to meet them earlier this evening. So we're going to move him up and allow him to have that brought to the front. All right, moving on to council announcements. Councilwoman Ms. Cook.
I just would have a thank you, actually. I would like to extend, with all the successful Mardi Gras events that were held in the last 2 weeks, I would like to thank all the support staff that made these events possible. I want to thank the various departments that had a role, all the men and women in uniform that were there to keep order, and the public works staff for their work with the barricades and cleanup. Your works did not go unnoticed by the council, administration, and especially all the citizens and visitors who enjoyed the festivities. Again, thank you very much.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Any other council announcements? Seeing none, at this time, we'd like to move over to the Executive Mayor President's Report. I'd like to recognize Mayor President Robidoux.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If you could make Lori's mic live, she's going to present the first piece.
All right, Ms. Toops, your mic is hot and live.
Good evening. We have on the agenda the receipt of the budget to actual comparison financial statements of all major funds. This is to comply with the new statewide auditing procedures. You may recall that we are doing this once a month as required by those procedures, and it must be reflected in the minutes of the council meeting. Those financial statements were sent to you last week.
Okay.
And Mr. Chairman, if you don't mind, I have a report that will be available to each of the councilmen and women from the Urban Land Institute that came here fairly recently and with the help of the Kresge Foundation to do an analysis on infill and some of the things that we can do as a city as it relates to urban development. And so that report now is out and available to the public, and I'm happy to say that some of the recommendations that they've made we've actually already done, but they talk about a lot of opportunity that we have. In conjunction with that, or certainly in relation to that, I also wanted to let you guys know that towards the end of this week, probably on Friday, we're going to be sending out RFQs, requests for qualifications, to developers that have both reached out to us and that we have reached out to as it relates to the redevelopment of the old federal courthouse site, so that we can get proposals in, we can get ideas, and we can see what it is the development community thinks makes sense on that site. Once that happens, I think the RFQ calls for maybe a 45-day window, and I could be a little bit off. We will look at all of those and certainly reach back out to the council for their input. And as we negotiate our way through doing something along that site, ultimately it will take council approval before we do any type of contract. But as that works its way through the process, we will keep you abreast of the different ideas that come out of that RFQ. And my hope is that, as I think most of you know, the parish budget, which I think we're going to address sometime later this meeting, has its challenges, and we need to do everything that we can to enhance the parish budget. And so, you know, as simple as I can make it is, you either have to raise revenue, you have to make more cuts, or you have to figure out ways to bring in additional revenue. And so we're trying to identify underutilized, underdeveloped, vacant properties that exist out there. Anything we can do to encourage that development and to start to have it happen means that it's money that will then be collected on that property that will benefit the parish budget. And certainly the downtown area is ripe for a lot of development. There's not many pockets throughout the parish where there's $200-400 million dollars of potential development. And so anything we can do to encourage that, we're going to look into it. Obviously, we're going to do it in as fiscally responsible way to the taxpayers. But as that development occurs, I think we will all be relieved to see that it will mean dollars for the parish budget, which, as you know, means the DA's office, the judge's office, parks and recreation, parish-wide fire protection, all those things that we look at to have to cut as the parish general fund continues to decline, which, you know, we've crossed our fingers and hoped that we'd see some reversal here just in my 2 years, and that has not happened, which means that it started, you know, in late 14, and it's continued all the way through 15, 16, 17, and it's not showing any signs of really leveling off. And so we need to take a long, hard look at what we can do to put places into commerce and see if we can fix some of that problem, you know, with smart investments. That's all for me. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Ms. Williams, you said we have a guest.
We do have a speaker request under item number 4AB, Michael Walden.
Hi, just very quickly, my name is Mike Walden, Dr. Michael Walden. I live in Lafayette. I was disappointed to see these documents, A and B, that were posted for this item. The documents are not machine readable. They look like they're not even a very good quality fax, so it makes it very hard for citizens to read them. Also, back long ago when I started working for the federal government in the year 2000, we were always dogged by the question of the ADA. And the ADA requires that you have machine-readable documents when you publish them online for a government agency. And I don't know if that covers you. It certainly did us. And we had to work to make sure that everything that we put up was machine-readable. So I hope that you will work and make progress on converting your documents, or just asking people when they turn in a document for one of these items to turn in a machine-readable copy so you can post that. And that's fairly easy, and it means that people can read them on their computers more easily. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. All right, moving right along to ceremonial presentations. At this time, I'd like to turn it over to Councilman Boudreaux. Jeremy, go ahead and read.
Beaver Park Pavilion Restoration by Eagle Scout Nicholas Begna.
Councilman Boudreaux.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members, it is my honor and pleasure to recognize a young man for some work that was done actually in one of our facilities as he was moving forward to earn his Eagle Scout badge in ranking. We had this actually on the agenda early in the year, but unfortunately with the weather events and health reasons within the family, they were not able to be with us, but they are here today. As a matter of fact, he also has his brother with him, who I'm going to also recognize in a second, who's right behind him in that process. But before we call them up, I think we have a presentation and take a look at his work.
It's a big job just getting by, 9 kids and a wife. Crew.
Great music selection.
I've prepared a letter, and I'm going to ask Mr. Nicholas Begno, his scoutmaster, and all of the scout team to come forward. Nicholas, I've recently received notification of you having achieved the rank of Eagle Scout. Congratulations. You should be very proud of this wonderful accomplishment, for I am very much aware of the commitment and dedication required to achieve this rank. You have obviously demonstrated not only your dedication to achieving this rank, but you have undoubtedly exhibited your leadership skills and abilities as well. Nicholas, it is important to note that these qualities are the key ingredients in becoming a good citizen and leader in our community. My challenge to you is to continue the journey and build upon the good foundation you obviously have forged as an Eagle Scout. The future of our community, and our country for that matter, looks a little brighter with the news of the achievements of people like yourself. Along with the entire council and the mayor president, please accept our heartfelt congratulations and know that people of the Lafayette community at large are very proud of you. It is signed by myself as well as sealed by the clerk of the council, Ms. Veronica Williams, and this is be something you'll be able to display for a lifetime. And in addition to that, we're gonna also present you with one of our lapel pins representing the Lafayette Consolidated Government Council as well. That was some unbelievable work. I'm glad to see you're doing better. Where's mom? She's not with you?
No, sir.
She couldn't make it today, okay. So dad's here, okay. Come forward, dad. Come get video from the front. You could get it here. We highlight a whole lot worse stuff than that tonight, I promise you. Let's get some of the good stuff out there, but get a good shot of him. But we just cannot say thank you enough. And this is what it's all about. This is when Lafayette is at its best. So if there are any other Eagle Scouts in the audience at this time, we would like you to stand where you are as we recognize this newest member of your awesome organization. Any other Eagle Scouts? Our very own Lo Duyon. All right.
All right, Lo.
It won't be long before we right back here. I want to recognize his younger brother, Luke, who's following right behind him in his footsteps. And Luke, I don't know if you've had the opportunity to do your citizenship yet. If so, you're going to get even more today. But I also want to present you with a lapel pin as well. And thank you for coming out in support of Big Brother.
Thank you. That's awesome.
We'd like to thank City of Lafayette for, we're looking for projects for Eagle Scouts to do, and y'all have a number of projects. You've supplied the material and we supply the labor. So thank you very much. And these boys, you'll have a long line of them coming up, not only from our troop, but from other troops. And just to get the record straight, Harold Scheffler's sitting in the back. He didn't stand up. He claims he's I'm older than him, but he was my patrol leader when I was a kid. I want you to know that. Nick is 131.
First off, I just want to thank all of you for giving your time in this meeting, for having me here. It was fun doing the project because now you see people took something that wasn't being used and now it is. So, kind of lost for words, but again, my greatest thank you to all of you and you, Mr. Robodeau, for having me here. So, thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That's all I have.
Okay, Mr. Boudreau, thank you very much. All right. Moving right along to comments from the public. The portion of our meeting is an opportunity to make your voice heard before the council, the administration, and the public. This is the time to speak about topics that are not included as agenda items. As I noted earlier, requests to make comments specific to an agenda item should be made prior to the call for that agenda item by completing an electronic request to address the council form for each agenda item in which you wish to address. Please, we request that all matters regarding specific city parish employees be directed to the administration and not to be addressed at this public forum. We as a council have a concern for privacy and protection of government employees. With that said, however, if your concern is not resolved in either an expeditious or satisfactory fashion, there are other avenues in which can be pursued, and we ask that you follow up with the council office. Also, confrontational statements and or threats will not be tolerated. We ask that you conduct yourself in a civil manner and with the same courtesy that you would expect of others. The five-minute rule is in effect, and again, just a reminder from the beginning of the council meeting, I announced that you are entitled to 5 minutes, and in the event that you got all your answers and everything that you need within 3 minutes or less, or 4 minutes or less, then at that point, council will move on to the next speaker so we can keep the meeting going. But you have a full 5 minutes, and you may take the full 5 minutes as long as everything has been answered to your best. And if you have questions, we'll make sure that you write them down and give it to council clerk. Therefore, at that point, she can direct it to the directors or whoever needs to address it or whoever can answer that question better, and it will get back with you. First speaker, please.
First speaker, Mr. Chair, is Andy Abair, who signed in as a registered city voter and signed in a second time as a registered parish voter.
Good evening. I'd first like to know which blue card you're going to recognize so I can be on topic.
We're going to be recognized as a resident of the parish and the city. One card, 5 minutes.
So as a registered city voter, I don't get the same equal treatment and voice as a registered parish voter. And since it's chair rules, that's your rule. I'd like council to vote to allow me to speak on each, as each individual voter.
Mr. Escott, in regards to the blue card that we're talking about, it's not chairman's rule, that's actually the order in which Robert rules of order, right?
Resolution. Business, how you conduct business, and you gave Ms. Abair the appropriate answer.
Okay, thank you. You may continue.
Respectfully ask the chair to call for a vote to allow me twice.
Anybody want to make a motion?
Thank you. Now I understand. I was alarmed, Mr. Robidoux, like you said, by the newspaper article in The Advocate. The exception among the municipalities was the city of Lafayette, where the retail continued to slump. Sales in unincorporated parts of the parish also dropped for the third straight year. So I was trying to figure out, how does this budget work? See, I got a copy of your budget document. So let's see. Broussard taxes, do y'all control them? Are they in your budget? No, they're controlled by the registered voters of the city of Broussard and the mayor. City of Karen Crow, are they in your budget? No, they're controlled by the people who elected the mayor and council that only live in the city of Karen Crow. City of Doosan taxes, is that in your budget? No, they're only controlled by the elected officials in their city, by those people. Youngsville taxes, are they in your budget? No, they're only controlled by the city elected officials who actually have to live in the city. City of Scott taxes, y'all don't control that either. They're only controlled by the city of Scott, and all these taxes can only be spent in those cities as voted on by the residents of those cities. City of Lafayette taxes, oh wait, that is in your budget document. But you're elected by everybody in the parish, not by the people inside the corporate limits of the city, like the other municipalities. Parish taxes, that's in your budget document also. I know, because I pay both a city and a parish tax. What's interesting is, you put the money in the document, and it's green. So how am I to know what part of that is my city money and what part of that is my parish money? Because you just put it under one document. It's been a year since I've filed a petition to de-annex my property from the city. I have never received any response from anyone, not the mayor president, not any of the council members, not even from my own district representative. In response, it's been a year. I handed that to you. I'd like to know, what is the status of the LUS in lieu of tax lawsuit that was filed? I'd like to know where that is. So consolidation is indeed working as predicted by the technical report. It said that the city and the unincorporated parish would join into further debt. And that's all that's happened. The small towns are growing. Their tax bases are growing. The city of Lafayette is not. It's interesting, you're going to ask us to vote in April on two separate property taxes. You pass two separate resolutions, but you won't let me speak as two separate taxpayers. Is that freedom of speech? Is that equal protection? I don't think it is. I don't think it's fair. Y'all joke about how District 6 represents 100% of the city residents and District 9 represents only 6% of the city. I don't believe that's equal representation. And if you look in the charter, it says we should have equal city residents in the city of Lafayette districts and in the parish of Lafayette districts. So I think you need to look at the gerrymandering of the districts the way they are.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Mr. Chair, we request that we take about three, four minutes to reboot the entire system. It's frozen.
Okay. Can we still call?
It was a white wall, and everybody was just a silhouette. And then Gidry called me.
All right. We back up? Okay. Continue the meeting and call our next speaker, please.
Next speaker, Melanie Brevis.
I'm sorry. Councilman Cone, you have the floor.
Okay. I couldn't let some of the comments made by Mr. Hebert go by without some explanation. To better understand our budget process, yes, we have one budget document, but within that budget document are four major budgets, one for the city of Lafayette, one for the parish of Lafayette, one for LUS, our utility system, and one for LUS Communications. And the stipulation is, because Lafayette remains a legal entity, we can only spend city revenues within the city of Lafayette. However, parish revenues can be spent throughout the parish. Oh, okay. Regarding your issue about being a parish registered voter and a city registered voter, as anyone else who has registered to vote in Lafayette Parish, we do so at the Lafayette Parish Registrar of Voters Office.
Yes, she.
And then that allows you to vote in what ever is the appropriate election where you reside. If it's a City of Lafayette election, yes. If it's in Council District 6, yes. If it's in Council District 5, no. So you are a registered voter in Lafayette Parish, which determines how and where you can vote. Just wanted to make that clarification. Thank you, Andy.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Bruce. Okay. Not seeing anything else. Okay, next speaker, please.
Final speaker, Melanie Brevis.
Good evening. My name is Melanie Brevis. I live in the Broadmoor neighborhood, District 8. I just wanted to come up here and speak again briefly on flooding drainage projects. I know we've made a lot of progress in the past month. I think that's great. I'm glad we got the $11 million. Yay. I know we've got the $9 million to do our own projects locally, and I think that's a big improvement as well. But what I would like to request is the following. I would like to request that there's an update at every council meeting on what progress has been made with regards to these projects, as well as what funds have been spent. I know that Councilwoman Hebert has said she was going to do that in her newsletter, and I think that's a great idea. And I would also like to see that at the council level if it's not something that's going to be updated and posted online on a regular basis. Two, I would really like to encourage you to continue to work with neighborhoods which have flooded or have come close to flooding. I know Guy Cormier mentioned at the Acadiana Planning Commission meeting on February 14th that some of these drainage projects will take years to complete. And we know that we will get our next heavy rainfall or flooding much before then. For example, I know at Plantation Townhomes, they're still waiting for a pump to be repaired. We in Broadmoor submitted at least 14 separate public works requests for different parts of our neighborhood back in September, and we still have not received any update on those, even though I have followed up with Liz repeatedly, and I know she was trying to get in touch with Public Works about those. And my main question there is just what will be done to prevent people from flooding again in the meantime. There are ways you can work with the families to provide them with short-term solutions, whether that be aquadams, massive sandbagging, et cetera, because these people are all citizens, and I think we all deserve that. And my third request is that you really think long and hard about any development project that will add impermeable surface space near areas which have already flooded. I am not against development per se. I am just against paving over every green space. And when I drive up and down Ambassador Caffrey and up and down Johnston, I pretty much just see for sale signs on every single forest lot or field. And I don't think those areas need to be developed when there are plenty of empty, abandoned lots around town that can simply be redeveloped. One example is the continuing commercial development by Costco. Quail Hollow flooded in August, parts of it flooded again in November, and they just simply cannot absorb any more runoff. And I know we have new development standards that might protect new structures, but it will do nothing for homes that have been built to previous standards. And I think a really good example of development is the shopping center that's across from Costco on Ambassador. That's a completely redeveloped center. It gave a really fresh new look to a shopping center that had previously just kind of been sitting there. And now it's just prettier. And I think we could do that all over town. And I would like to see that strategy done more. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. No more speakers. Okay. All right, moving along to the resolutions. This is a public hearing, and blue sheets are available for anyone wishing to address the council. The five-minute rule does apply. Jeremy, can you please read?
Resolution 8, 2018, a resolution of the Lafayette City Parish Council requesting the assistance of the Louisiana Congressional Delegation in assessing the costs, benefits of three regional stormwater projects potentially impacting the parish of Lafayette and in seeking federal funding to move forward immediately with said projects.
All right. I got a motion by Councilman Kong. Need a second. Second by Councilman Lewis. I'll give the floor to one of the authors to explain the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Before we move on, I'd like to consider submitting an amendment in two areas. One would be in the title of the resolution. Initially, we had three regional stormwater projects that we wanted to promote. However, that has increased beyond that number. And the increase is reflected later in the whereas is another two amendments to add two bullet points to what we're requesting, federal review and potential federal funding. And once those amendments are adopted, if it's okay, I'd like to go ahead and read the resolution. Okay. I would propose those amendments to eliminate three from the title and then add the two whereas's bullet points.
Okay. And Mr. Boudreau seconds that amendment. Any council discussion in regards to the amendment that Mr. Bruce Conk had made? Seeing none. Any public comment?
We do have five speakers. I'm not sure if they want to speak to the amendment. I could call out their names and if they would like to speak to the amendment. Sarah Scheffler, for the resolution.
She'll speak to them.
Because you'll still get the opportunity to speak to the resolution. Cynthia Trahan.
Okay. She's going to pass.
Dave Dixon. Dave Dixon. Resolution. Okay. Bob Hammack. Harold Scheffler. That's
okay.
It.
All right. Please call the vote for the amendment.
District 1?
Yes.
2?
Yes.
District 3?
Yes.
District 4?
Yes.
District 5?
Yes.
District 6?
Yes.
District 7?
Yes.
District 9?
Yes.
Motion to amend is approved.
All right. At this time, we go ahead and go to public comment on the amendment. You want to read the resolution? Okay. Mr. Cole.
Beg the indulgence of the public and the fellow council members, but I think this needs to be stated out loud because it's significant in how we approach things in stormwater management. We've already read the title to the resolution. The resolution itself says, be it resolved by the Lafayette City Parish Council that whereas in August 2016, the parish of Lafayette experienced a historic rain event that impacted thousands of residents and businesses. And whereas in May, August, and November of 2017, significant rainfall again disrupted the lives and livelihood of residents of the parish of Lafayette. And whereas in the past 18 months, the parish of Lafayette has experienced four traumatic rain events resulting in widespread loss of property and major disruption in the lives of homeowners and damage to businesses. And whereas in 2017, the Lafayette City Parish Council established stricter drainage stormwater development standards to be administered by Lafayette City Parish Consolidated Government. And whereas in November 2017, parish voters approved a rededication of funds from existing property tax millages to increase revenues for maintenance of drainage channels. And whereas Lafayette City Parish Consolidated Government, utilizing these revenue increases, is focused on aggressive maintenance of drainage channels and has identified and prioritized improvement projects within the parish of Lafayette. And whereas a public forum on January 30th, 2018, sponsored by the Acadian Group of the Sierra Club, identified projects outside of the parish of Lafayette that potentially could better manage stormwater and provide significant relief from floodwaters within the parish of Lafayette. And those are drainage from Bayou Catawba into the Atchafalaya Basin, dredging shallow areas of the Vermilion River, improved drainage of the Cypress Island Swamp, open the Keystone Lock on an experimental basis to evaluate changes in river stages, water quality, impacts, and other benefits, and allow Lake Martin to become part of the Cypress Island Retention Zone. Whereas these suggested improvements either fall under the jurisdiction of the U.S. Corps of Engineers or require federal funding, now therefore be it further resolved by the Lafayette City Parish Council. Section 1 is that all of the aforedescribed whereas clauses are adopted as part of this resolution. Section 2, the Lafayette City Parish Council respectfully solicits assistance of Louisiana's congressional delegation in assessing the costs, benefits of these proposals and seeking federal monies to immediately implement. And that is the context of the resolution for which I'm seeking council support, along with fellow council member Nanette Cook and Liz Hebert.
Okay. All right, thank you, Bruce. I'm not seeing any other council discussion. We'd like to go to the blue cards in regards to the ordinance as well.
Okay, Mr. Chair, we did have two citizens who did not wish to speak, who signed in to support the resolution. The first of five speakers, Sarah Scheffler.
Good afternoon and thank you. My name is Sarah Scheffler from Lafayette. A regional approach to watershed drainage for all of our flooding was an issue in a meeting that was held at the Light Center, where our governor came in and said how excited he was that we were doing this as a region, and we were awarded $25 million to make that happen because of the regionality of all of this. I'm delighted that our Acadiana Regional Planning Commission has set up an approach to getting this. Some of what I support, some of what some I think is putting a cart before the horse. And what I would like to see happen is that coulees can't be cleaned out before a river that's clogged up, that is proven by a 2017 study and a report by the Army Corps of Engineers that says we've got areas in this river that are plus 1 feet, and you know, water just can't go in there without coming back out because it can just handle so much of this flood water. And so if we clean out all of our coulees beforehand and we rush all of that water down to a river that's incapable of handling it, where is it going but back up the coulees into your homes? And so these are some of the things that we need to look at, and we appreciate y'all putting this resolution forward. We ask and strongly ask that all of you get after our congressional delegation and ask them. This is no money out of Lafayette's pocket. It is something that is a federal project that they need to get in and redredge the river. Some of the other things that I think of as regional is our own detention pond, our natural detention pond up at Lake Martin, to open that up into the river with gates that would be wonderful. It would clear out of the water that's in Lake Martin. It would put fresh water in there as well. And it's a 20,000 acre foot detention pond. You know, it's a natural detention pond there. We also have the efforts of St. Martin Parish, which is another regional partner of ours, that would like to help lower the waters in Cypress Island Swamp into Lake False Point, which naturally goes down and drains in to the Gulf. And so these are things that can be done, but we need your support to get behind them and get behind our congressional district. And I think that this will achieve a lot for us. We also have water that comes down from Bahia Catawba, which is the feeding part from Cocodri and I forget the other bayou up around Alexandria and all, but that was dumping a lot of water into our area. And Harold and I drove out the other day and saw where Catawba has been weirded off and dammed off, and it was just, with the small amount of rain we had, it was just crashing over the top of this weir into it. And so there are already existing gates in the levee into Henderson that if we go in and widen these gates, we can put a lot of that water that's coming from up north to us there before it even hits us. So anyway, look at this resolution. We thank you for bringing it forward, and we hope that you will get after our congressional delegation. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Next speaker, Cynthia Trahan.
Hi, good evening. My name is Cynthia Trahan. I am a resident of Derby Heights, so I'd like to say thank you for the time to address the council this evening. Tonight, I come with a lot of frustration on my heart about this resolution, and I'm just simply asking for answers, seeking for answers. So first, I want to remind the council that, number one, Derby Heights was one of the last neighborhoods to come up from the floodwaters that happened back in August 2016. For nearly 2 weeks, we were still traveling by boats when all other neighborhoods were gutting out their homes and taking things out to dry, but we were still traveling by boat. Countless phone calls was made to the media, United Way, Red Cross, nothing. Nothing happened. We were left out there to fend for ourselves, and that's what we did. We had to take care of ourselves. So let's talk about what happened since the August 2016 flood. In May 2017, the board approved a little over $1 million project for Derby Heights for drainage. To this date, we still have no information as to what is going on with that project, what has happened with that project, a timeline, anything. We don't have anything. November 2017, the voters voted for a rededication of funds for drainage cleanup, which was approximately $9 million. Again, Derby Heights was not on that list. Webb Cooley was not on that list. February 2018, just a few weeks ago, LCG announced another drainage project, which amounts up to about $25 million. And Derby Heights and Webb Cooley, again, was still not on that list. So my question is, how was it determined which Cooleys were evaluated, and how did they make the list? And why wasn't Webb Cooley evaluated? You know, because living in Derby Heights, we're property owners. That's our homes. And every time it rains for a few hours or so, that coulee tops over, waters in our yards, in the streets, in the ditches, and yet we're praying again. So how can we get this, how do we get Webb Cooley evaluated to determine? We didn't even make the list to know what needs to be done. It would be different if we was on the list and we was the last in section C, but we didn't even make the list. It didn't even get evaluated. So I'm asking, how was that determined that it was not evaluated? And what can we do to get it evaluated? Because as a property owner, we want to protect our property for a lifetime. This is property that we want to leave to our children. But we can't do that if we continue to be inundated with floodwaters from this coulee. Again, I just ask for answers to find out what can we do, what needs to be done. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Councilman Boudreaux.
Thank you. I'm going to just respond to a couple of these. Derby Heights is in District 4. I had the opportunity to spend a couple hours out there Sunday with a couple of the residents in their home. in response to some of these same mentions. One of the things that I did discover since then is that the 1,051,000 that was dedicated to Derby Heights for construction and engineering of a project, as I indicated, some of the work has begun. Construction has not begun, but the environmental assessments has started. It's indicated that the timelines may in fact take a couple of months depending on the project impact on the surrounding wetlands as far as dealing with the Corps of Engineers. Then it's indicated after the environmental assessment, then the engineering firm, whoever was to receive that bid at that point, would start design work. It is to be noted that HUD requires a collection of applications from engineering firms and approve the best qualification firms. Timeline is 2 to 3 months for advertising, review, and awarding and enacting. So dating back to August of 2016, to current time, when you look at the time that it took to secure those funds, and there was 3 projects, by the way, in those funds, 2 others in another district. Some work has begun, but construction has not. As it relates to Webb Cooley, as I indicated this weekend, I did have the opportunity to speak with the mayor president and share some additional insight on our most recent flood management and maintenance that has been deployed with the rededication of those tax dollars. And I think we do have some agreement that we need to broaden the scope of what we're looking at as it relates to maintenance. Some things have been qualified as erosion. My position on that is we don't have erosion coulees, we have drainage coulees. And if erosion is taking place and trees and fences and other things are falling in and dirt is silting and minimizing the channel's capacity, well, then that means it needs maintenance. So we did need to look at that. There are a few other channels that was not in the list for various reasons. And then on an expansion of that, there are some new concerns. Tonight we're going to hear from the Acadiana Planning Commission's update, but I could tell you that there are some projects that are referenced in our program and their program and others. So I would just ask that Derby Heights remain engaged, continue to follow and ask the questions. I'll certainly get as much information to you as possible that I could access, but like I said, after speaking with the mayor, I'm waiting to see Acadiana Planning Commission's presentation today with the list comparisons and see what options we have as far as advancing some of these projects. Early on in this process, when we were soliciting for the rededication, this was one of my concerns, because everybody, and after that first night, I never forget, there were a number of neighborhoods here, none of which were mine, but everybody wants to go first. Somebody's gonna be first, somebody's gonna be last. So all I have to count on is a fair assessment process, a fair tool to be put in place, and then I would have to accept the results. I think we had a good tool, but I have said that the tool needs to be improved upon, and that's where we're in agreement, is that for the first time, something was done that had never been done before. But the results that it produced just still didn't get us where we needed to get. And then the fact that some channels was not considered for various reasons, whether it was what list they fell on or how they were categorized, I think that needed to be looked at. So Webb Cooley is going to be ultimately assessed and evaluated going forward. This particular project, to the greatest speed possible, it's going to be expedited. But again, for those who are not familiar with the government process, a lot of people like to compare government to the private sector because that just sounds good politically. But government comes under greater scrutiny than anybody because it's other people's money that's being spent. And so the timelines, the biddings, what has to get approved, what has to be yay and nayed, when you could do what. I got some other constituents in here tonight based on Surrey Street Bridge. in that outing. And as fast as things could have been done, they've been done. But at the end of the day, that project is still a project that's going to probably be completed sometime this summer, because the process is the process. So hopefully that addresses some of those concerns, and we'll continue to talk about them. But I just didn't want you all to come out tonight and at least not hear something as it relates. But I was able to get from community development where we were with the funding and what assessments had been done to this point. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Boudreaux. Next speaker, please.
Dave Dixon.
Thank you. My name is Dave Dixon. I'm a resident of the south part of the parish.
So Dave, can you pick the mic maybe above your computer? Will it work? There you go.
Does this help maybe?
Can you pick the mic up itself? There you go. Thank you, sir.
Right. And I want to thank the council members and other distinguished attendees of the public hearing we had at the South Regional Library on January 31st. And I want to especially thank council members Bruce, Nanette, and Liz for putting forth this resolution that I strongly support. And what I'm going to talk to today is just to give you a little overview of one of the items in that resolution of like what's happening up there. It was recommendation number one in Bruce's list there. It's encouraging the Army Corps of Engineers to implement the Catawba floodplain, which involves enlarging the gates on the levee. Okay, on February 14th, we were at the APC FEMA flood mitigation meeting in Opelousas, and after that meeting, a visit was made to the West Chaffee Spillway levee to go take a look at what was going on up there. Okay. And immediately prior to 14th, there was no rain recorded in this area south of 190 or the greater Lafayette area. So we're going to give you some visual data about why this thing needs to be done here. And just give you a little background for the folks that's not familiar with this issue, is that this bi-Catawba, that the water comes down and comes to us, that watershed is large. I heard it's close to 1 million acres, been calculated at 1 million acres. It goes all the way up to Alexandria, and it roughly parallels I-49 on the west and the West Chaffee Spillway levee on the east side. And a little background, these gates we're talking about here, it's a satellite photograph of these gates. You can see the bayou comes up to the levee. There's some gates that go through the levee, and there's some weirs that are on the left side of that picture there as an overflow structure. And that's what the weir looks like. And then we were at the weir February 14th, and just to show you like what was going on here, I got a little video here. It'll play. No, I don't want to play, I don't know. Quick time not available. I'm sorry about that. But anyway, the water was running over the weir. That weir is 500 feet wide. Okay, and there's a second one down the channel there that's the same size. So there's a significant amount of water that's going over that weir. Okay. If we go to the next slide, that's the gates. And then that's downstream of the gates, and there was a huge current. I wish the video would play so you could see this amount of water, the volume of water that's coming through there. Okay, the side you're looking at here is the West Chaffee Spillway. This is north of Henderson Lake. This is where the water needs to go. The problem is these gates are too small, okay? And that's the reason the water is running over the weirs, okay? And at the same time, back here in Lafayette, you know, what was going on back here, we were seeing some of that water coming back around to us. You see that rise, the gauge at Karen Crow? The jumped up there, that's water that's coming from up there down to us. You can also see it in that second graph to the right. in the volume in Surrey Street that's coming through their gauge right there. So the water up from the north is coming down the Vermilion River from this structure, because this structure is undersized. So that's one of the reasons why, that's the reason why one of those items in the resolution was recommended. Other thing I'd like to say is that, you know, we received a survey from the Corps of Engineers. The river's in really, really bad shape. We've analyzed that survey. About 100% of the river in the city of Lafayette does not meet the specifications of the dredge that was done in 1950. The other thing I'd like to say, I'd like to recognize Jared Pretty, who's from Congressman Clay Higgins' office here. And we've been told Clay is on board with helping us get this money to get these projects done. The second thing is, but we may have a match, so we're going to have to deal with that, how we're going to come up with that money. Thank you for your time. I appreciate y'all's support.
Thank you, Mr. Dave. Appreciate it. Next speaker, please.
Bob Hammack.
Following that presentation, this is going to be amateur hour. That was just excellent stuff right there. And that's really why when I first got interested in this, because of, you know, my house flooding, I got to know Harold and Dave, and it's really been a great learning experience. Wish I could have learned it some other way than the way it happened, but it's nevertheless, that's what it is. And, you know, just to reiterate, first of all, I would like to echo the prior speaker's, you know, congratulations to you all for, you know, really taking a regional look at this thing, because those are the things that I think are going to make a difference and can really help everybody. I mean, it would be so great to see that, you know, we could get this flooding thing really under control, where we could take maybe another 25, 30 inch rain and have minimal flooding. And I really believe that's possible. One thing I would like to encourage all of you to do, because I know you're interested in this now, is Harold does a little tour where he'll take you up to Bayou Catawba and start and go down, and where you can really get a visual view of what he was showing you, like that we're at Bayou Catawba, and see how all this stuff works and see that it is real. It's not just, you know, some rantings of some mad scientist. And I just really think that it, you know, I'm not going to use all my time today, but I think that it's really good that the regional view is starting to, you know, or is catching on, because that's how the problem's going to be solved. It's not going to be solved by cleaning somebody's coulee or quite frankly digging retention ponds, but I don't want to go negative here. But so I'm really encouraged by that. I think one thing that maybe I would suggest, and this is not a huge deal, but the part of the reason that the Vermilion has shoaled up so much is because we have concrete coulees in Lafayette, and I think we should clean the dirt coulees, or the ones that don't have concrete in them. Again, though, it has to be done in conjunction with dredging the river, because if you clean the coulees out and you don't dredge the river, the water's just going to go down to the river and back right back up, and everybody's going to be going, what happened? You clean my coulee and we're still flooding. But one thing that would probably be good is the rate of flow from concrete coulees is really, really fast. It's comparable to that you get in a mountain stream with a, you know, 20 degree grade. And what happens as a result of that is that the coulees, it's, you think that a coulee that had a dirt or like a creek, a sediment on the bottom, would carry more sediment into the river, but the opposite is true. The concrete coulees carry a lot of sediment to the river, And so we could probably help with some of the sedimentation of the river or the shoaling of the river if we they put some small, just something to slow it down, not stop it. Of course, we don't want to do that. But anyway, that's one thing that, that could be done, and I'm sure a number of other ideas will be broached and discussed and whatnot. But, you know, I'm really heartened by the fact that you all are getting behind this, the Bayou Catawba, Cyber Silent Swamp, Lake St. Martin, the Tesh, and Dredge and the Vermilion, because that's what's going to make a difference for this whole community, and it can help everybody, not just somebody in one neighborhood versus another, this, that, and the other. And it could have a huge impact because it could make Lafayette a place where people want to come to because it doesn't flood. You know, it would be tremendous to see that happen. So thank you all very much.
Okay. Thank you very much. Next speaker.
Final speaker, Harold Scheffler.
First of all, I want to thank all of you who came to our flood meeting on January 30th at Southside Library. I want to apologize to the many people who wanted to come and couldn't get in and couldn't even get in the overflow room. But I think it's important that citizens are very concerned about this, and they're somewhat optimistic that it can be resolved. I certainly want to commend this council for taking this action. You set an example for other councils. We hope other councils in the region follow your example and lead. It's super important that you, as a first level of elected officials, send a message to our congressional delegation that is something that needs and can be fixed. The more we looked into this, you know, a little history 101, this problem came about because of building of the levees. If you look at the watershed, the Catawba watershed goes all the way up to Alexandria. It goes up to Boyce, where our power plant is, way west of Alexandria. So it goes way up there, 7 million acres. All of that water drained into the Chaffly River. We put a big levee in the way. Now we expect it to drain down to Bayou Tesh. The Chaffly River is a 100,000-foot channel. It's 1,000 feet wide, 100 feet deep. Bayou Catawba is a 5,000-foot channel. It's 25 by 200. The Bayou Tesh is 700 feet. It's like putting 100 gallons in a 5-gallon bucket. It won't and can't work. The more we've looked at this, the more we're convinced that flood saves in the Vermilion can be lowered very significantly. And one of the things that we struck on was the Keystone Lock. All the water has to go either down to Tesh or down to Vermilion. But it's difficult getting down to Tesh because there's a big dam in the way and a lock. Well, we found out in 1927 that lock was open for the flood. It should have been open this time. Had we done that, we were at the lowest stages on the Vermilion, approximately 4 to 5 feet. Derby Heights and a lot of other homes would not have been flooded. 40% of the homes in the Tesh Vermilion watershed had less than a foot. So if we lowered 4 feet just by opening that gate, no cost. Problem is that we don't have a flood operating procedure when we open the Catawba gates, when we open the Darbon gates. Henderson has a gate. When the flood is coming through, that gate should be open. It's just a gate there to keep Henderson at 10 feet so the boat landings can accommodate the brim fishermen. So we need a flood operation plan. The cost to do just using the existing structures, we can significantly lower an event like we dealt with, a 24-inch rain. We are not like New Orleans, where you sit in a bowl and you're going to depend on pumps. We're on the high ground. And if we reestablished what we had historically, if you took the levee out of the way, we wouldn't have had a flood. The flood came not from Lafayette going north. We computed that. The amount of water going north is only 42,000 surface acre feet. It's less than 4% of the flood. It's not the problem here. That would only put a foot and a half of water in Cypress Island Swamp. And so the flood is coming from what was in Cypress Island, was almost 300,000 surface acre feet, over 30,000 acres. You had 10 feet of water over the swamp. That can and